Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another episode of In the Greenhouse, the relaxing behind-the-scenes series, here with Siri as we talk about our day. We answer some questions that you guys have submitted, give you some behind-the-scenes information about the different episodes and channels that we've, series that we've got running, and generally just get to know each other a little bit better. And today, we're going to dive in with some of my favorite kind of questions. Plant and animal related questions. I'm really excited to go through this pile, actually. I've been saving up quite a few of your plant and animal related questions. Oh, that's just a little checker. See, I was going to try to trim that plant because I thought it had a little dead spot, but it looks like that's just a checker. But that's definitely a dead spot on my cactus. Ah, it has been very busy here in our greenhouse. I accidentally left the game running for about a day and a half and forgot about it. And when you do that, a lot of things die. Thankfully, the cacti didn't really peter out too quickly, but I lost all of my current pitcher plants. Thankfully, even when plants die in Plant Tycoon, they might still have seeds on them, so I was able to- Ooh! Dragonfly! Come here, little one! Come here! There! I wonder where I sell them to. Who knows? Who knows? But thankfully, I still had the seeds on those pitcher plants, so our rare pitcher plant seeds- Ah, oh, that draws such a fast little spider! Our rare pitcher plant seeds continue on, and we have our little fuzzy seeds. And these little fuzzy seeds actually turn into a very fascinating cactus. So I'm very happy to have some of its variety. We're gonna tuck a couple of them away. Let's see, for safety. See, you can see what it looks like. Isn't it adorable? It's a little golden berry cactus. Totally unique shape. We've not had that cactus shape before either. And speaking of unique shapes, that actually brings up one of my very first questions from Trinity. Are there any evolutionary paths you find fascinating? Or what are some congruent evolutions that you find fascinating? And really, that's a very hard question for me to answer, because if you stop and you think about any of the evolutionary paths, they're all fascinating. Why does a cow have four stomachs? Why do horses have cloven hooves, like the hard hooves? And why do some animals have cloven hooves? Marsupials! What is up with marsupials? I'm like, oh, but probably if I had to think about my favorite type of camouflage, it would of evolution, it would be camouflage. Mimicry, really, as a specific, like, part of that camouflage. Yeah, mimicry. Any of the animals that look like other animals, or especially look like plants, that you look at a picture of them and you wouldn't be able to tell right away what they are. And I think that's really interesting, especially since in that, oh, look at everybody grow so fast, I'm so proud of them. Especially because it can happen really fast, too. In terms of generations, that famous moth study, the moths who were dark gray survived and began to propagate and thrive, even though they were the same species as moths who were white. And all those ones got eaten up because when the factory was built, nearby, their little forest, the soot would settle on everything and make it easier to see the white moths. So within just a few generations of those moths, all the moths started to lean more towards being gray, so they could blend in. So I find any of those things fascinating, really regardless of what the animal is or what their trait is. And it's just a way of unraveling a mystery. That's kind of what I love about evolution and the study of evolutionary history, is unraveling the mystery of why that species became what it has become, or what it was, if it's extinct, or if it's changed. It's interesting to see how species have changed over time and remember that their current form doesn't exactly represent the best version of what that species might be capable of. They may not as be fat, and they might not be as fast or as prolific as variations of themselves that have come before. They're just the most adaptable. So that's what I love about studying evolutionary biology and history, because it tells you so much about the way the world once was, and I think that's very important. Coupling that with studying the geography and studying what plants might have been around at that time, it can open up the picture of the past a lot better and kind of give us an idea of what the future might hold. So that's a really great question, Trinity. Thank you very much. If I come across anything really, really interesting, I'll do my best to try to gather up some details and share them with you guys. Because some of the things that are out there are just ridiculous. Look at our little cactus being so cute. It's just a little stick right now. And I have a present for you guys. We have a new little seed. Look at this seed. Isn't it so cool? It's got little bumps and it's got a little triangle shape. I spent our money on it because I've been not growing as many of our wonderful fabled plants as usual. I've been growing just kind of anything to experiment. So I've run low on money, but we're gonna try out this guy and see what it turns into as well. So in just a moment, we'll use the vapor bomb. Everybody else ready? Everybody else ready? Okay, I'm gonna use this. There we go. All right, and boom. Our last vapor bomb. I can't afford, what are you? It's like a little palm tree. I've never seen this one before. Oh, you're a cutie patootie. I like it, I like it. Good, 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 good. I feel that we have made a good choice. Let's load it up with some more flowers. Oh, now we're really running out of money. Well, time to sell some stuff. Da 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 da. Okay, we'll get this going. We'll sell you. Yeah, we've got some of those seeds in the back. So there we go. So now let's make some money back because we are getting very close to being broke. Now, some other questions. Let's see. My favorite domesticated plant and animal species by Nishwick. That's another good one. Favorite domesticated animal is probably the cat, to be honest. I know that's kind of, well, and the chicken. Definitely the chicken. I think the chicken, for being more of your, like, some people really consider chicken pets. I know I probably would consider chickens pets. I consider my finches pets, and they're not domesticated. The list of domesticated species in the world is actually very short, which I find interesting. For example, like camels. Camels count. But not zebras. You can't domesticate zebras. Isn't that weird? We can domesticate all these other species, but not a zebra. It's very interesting. Very interesting. But yeah, definitely the chicken and the cat as far as domesticated animals go. I love both of them. Cats I've always enjoyed a little bit more than dogs because dogs often come off as pretty needy. I love our Great Danes, though. I love our dogs. Like, don't get me wrong. I still love the dogs. But they want to be, like, totally engaged with you all the time. And so I like it more as a cat person, where the cat comes by and it's okay with hanging out with you when it wants to. And you don't feel obligated 24/7 to be with the dog. And some people thrive off of that kind of relationship. My uncle definitely does. He has his Labradors and they have an amazing relationship together. He loves being with them 24/7 and they love being with him 24/7. And he's got his whole little herd of Labradors and he takes them everywhere, takes great care of them. They eat better than most people I know. And it's wonderful, but not my personality style. I'm very happy to kind of go, huh, I wonder where my cat is, and look around for it until I find it snoozing under a chair or something, and then going, hey, can I pet you? And the cat's like, no. And so you're like, okay, I'll come back later. Or if the cat's like, yes, then it's like, okay, I'm good, after like 5 minutes of being pet. And I'm okay with that. I'm more like, it's easier for me in pretty much all my relationships to be able to go and interact with the people and the animals on my own terms. I guess I'm like a cat myself that way. But yeah, so yeah, what about plant species? Favorite domesticated plant? Probably okra. For some reason, okra is my all-time favorite vegetable right now, so okra's on the list. Also, why are these people not buying our plants? They're not that expensive. Oh dear. There might be hard times coming up for our nursery pretty soon. Oh, finally, good. I was really getting worried for a second there. And then Mandy wanted to know, how did I become so interested in snakes and plants and everything else? That's a great question. I think that, oh yay, everything sold. That's much better. I think that some people just naturally gravitate towards the things that they love. Some people enjoy fashion. Some people are obsessed with horses. Some people love working out. Some people love, like, watching television or going to plays or making music. And for me, just somehow plants, especially plants and animals, just are my thing. They're the thing that makes me so excited to, like, rush out the door and go see what's going on in the world. There we go. Now we'll get some more money and everything will be okay. I mean, it's not like my parents were particularly outdoorsy people. Like, going on a walk meant going up and down the street as a kid, you know what I mean? So it's not like my parents were world travelers. My mom definitely was an animal lover. My dad actually didn't like animals for the longest time because he didn't grow up with them, and he thought that they were just like a lot of work to add animals into the household. But mom managed to win him over, and eventually we ended up like with Quaker parrots and lots of cats, dogs, hamsters, guinea pigs, lovebirds, like everything. Just everything. And I think that the school I went to had a huge influence on me, because in my elementary school, they focused almost daily on the importance of conservation, the rainforest, the environment. The whole school was geared towards raising money every year at this big event, big festival that they held, so that we could purchase somehow. It was like you put the money down, and then they like gave the money to someone who protected some of the rainforest. It was a really cool elementary school looking back on it. It was just a public school, but they put a lot of work into teaching kids about the environment. Each class had its own little garden in the courtyards where you would go and you would take care of your garden. So I think my school, more than my family, really had the biggest impact on me for the early years of why I liked plants and animals. But once you get out of elementary school, I never ran into a school that cared that much again, ever, about that kind of relationship between students and the environment. Maybe that's why I try as hard as I do to really educate kids, especially, about why the planet is so important, because that's a crucial age to really be able to open up their eyes and get them to be passionate about something. Often people lose their passion as they get older. And I really don't feel like the planet that we share is something that you should feel disconnected from. So, I don't know. I'm sitting in my room looking around, and I'm surrounded by plants, and I've got my gecko tanks and my finch cages, and I've got bird food and stray cat food and spray millet set outside for all the animals to come by. Let's see, there's easily more than a dozen, maybe two dozen potted plants in this teensy apartment, with only one window. Somehow I'm helping them all thrive. It's a lot of work, actually. And I don't know how I got here. I really don't. I think I just followed my heart. And maybe that's kind of the answer there. You find your passion, like I said. Everyone loves something unique. And of course, as long as it doesn't hurt anyone, and as long as it's what motivates you to grow and push yourself so that you can achieve more for yourself in the world. And that doesn't mean material gain. That means a sense of purpose. And that's, oddly enough, what going on my walks every day, taking pictures of plants, studying why things evolved to be the way they have, gives me. It's a sense of purpose. Trying to do my best to educate people about how animals function, how we all share this world together, how everything is related in the environment, the ecosystem, it gives me a sense of purpose. And so I think that this is just the thing that clicked with me, and that it's become such a major factor in my life because I followed my heart. So if you guys have something that clicks with you like that, it can be anything. I think there's few things as beautiful as seeing someone in the full glory of what they're passionate about. When you can take away the fear of having to struggle for your own survival and just watch someone as they really intrinsically push themselves to become the best they can in terms of encouraging their own growth because of this greater purpose that they feel they have, I think that's something amazing. I think that's where some of the most amazing art, some of the most amazing inventions, creations, stories, like relationships, laughter, I think that's where that comes from, is where someone can find their purpose and feel safe enough and secure enough that they can just let themselves grow towards it. So I hope you guys all can find something like that too. It's taken me a long time to get here. I'm past my mid-20s now. And it took me a long time to be able to realize that even if what I did, learning about plants and animals and the environment and everything, didn't like pay the big bills. That's why I dropped out of my biology degree and switched to nursing. I thought I had to get the job that would make the most money because I needed to take care of my family. And so I thought, oh, I have to make sure that like, it can be my passion. I can have weekends and things to go hiking, but it would be irresponsible of me to, like, focus just on that when there's other things that make more money and my family needs money. And they do. My parents are both disabled, and my younger siblings have varying forms of autism. And as the eldest, I am the one who's responsible for taking care of them. And it's really hard sometimes, because it's been that way since I was very young. So it was really difficult for me to put aside my belief that I had to sacrifice my passion and my purpose to make money. And as soon as I finally was able to get over that with the help of my amazing, amazing fiance, I found that my family is happier. We may not have as much money as we need still, but I don't think we ever really would, even if I worked myself to the bone. So I'm really happy now, because I'm following my purpose. And it's very easy to hear someone say, oh, you know, just follow your heart, but you have to be smart about it. You can't just drop out of school and go walk across the world if it doesn't take care of your family, you know? But it's important to remember to balance that, because I thought, no, it's much more important to work smart and get a job that would take care of everybody than to be happy with what I do. And I guess that's really sad, because I look at what I've created on our channel and with the community just in the past 2 years. And if I had not abruptly had the free time to do that and abruptly had to stop studying because we moved, then I wouldn't have been able to create all of this. And my life has been transformed by doing it. And now that I'm happier, and now that I truly feel in sync with my purpose, even though things are still tough for my family, I feel like I actually have the strength to do whatever it takes to take care of them now. Which seems so weird. I thought whatever it takes to take care of your family meant that you got that high-paying job and you sacrificed the things that meant the most to your heart. And now I realize that that's not true. That if you want to have the strength to do whatever it takes for your loved ones, then you have to be able to keep alive that sense of purpose in your heart, so that while you do whatever it takes to take care of your loved ones, you're also alive, because you only get one shot at that too. So that's a major segue. I don't know quite how we got here, but for some of you, especially those of you who might be in college or high school or places like that, you hear all the time that you have to work hard and play hard, and you try to find the balance between those things. If you're like me, you thought it was all work. You think it's all work. You think that you will sacrifice whatever it takes so you can have the good job, not because you want the money, but because you love your family, because you want to have a safe future, because you don't want to be scared or hungry. And I can tell you from years of experiencing that if you only pursue that and you really don't have any glimmer inside of yourself, you just make excuses for why you're still going that track, and you really don't have any glimmer, any deeper sense of purpose in it, then your life will be very hollow. And you still love your family, but I don't think you can give them everything that your heart really can when it's like that. So I hope if you guys were like me, you'll be able to find that balance between sensibility and common sense and having the resources needed to practically take care of your family, but also be able to have the freedom to live. Live the way that you feel gives you your purpose. So, that's why I love plants and animals. That's why I love what I do. Because I feel alive for the first time in my life, being able to pursue this wholeheartedly. And like I said, even though things are still tough, and I know I could be making far more money if I was a nurse, I've honestly never seen my parents be happier with where I am than they are now. I've never seen such a look of peace on their faces, and I've never been in such a peaceful place in my own life that I can give them things that money can't buy. The love and the peace and the tranquility from my heart that I can give them now, I think provides much more for them than working 80 hours a week as a nurse ever would have. So it's definitely a balance. You still have to be practical about it, and you're not always going to find jobs you love, but you should be happy to be alive too. I think everyone deserves that. So this got very rambly and very serious, and I apologize for the segue. Normally, I don't dive into those kinds of things, but I feel it's very important for any of you who might be in the place that I once was to know that, yeah, it's not easy, but don't give up. You deserve to be happy too, and your loved ones will be happier when you have that radiant joy inside of you for when you're following what you really love. You have to be smart about it. Don't just drop out of school or any nonsense like that. Don't get me wrong. You still need practical skills and to pay the bills, but don't give up. So, alrighty. Much more serious Siri than usual. I got my name seriously because I used to be quite serious, believe it or not. No one believes me. Everyone thinks I'm just a goose bucket, but that's okay, because I love making people smile and laugh. Well, we'll move on to some of the more relaxed questions and the silly things next time, and I will get some more of our plants growing, because who knows what this amazing little fern is going to turn into. I'm so excited. All right, I will see you guys in a little bit. I hope you're having a wonderful day. Stay curious. And please remember, even when things are tough, you deserve to be happy. It's not always about the money. There are things that it can't buy. Just be smart too. Like I said, it's a balance. It's definitely a balance. And I hope you all can find the thing that makes you feel like you have a purpose. And it doesn't come right away. It took me years to figure out that, yeah, just going on hikes and taking pictures of mushrooms and ferns and things fulfilled that sense of purpose in me. Most people might look at you funny if you admit that, like, oh, well, making doll, miniature clay doll food is my purpose. That's just what makes me feel connected. But it could be whatever you want. Whatever. Well, no. I can tell you this as advice if you don't know what your purpose is. When you find it, it's not something that's a want or a desire. It's something so much more full of joy than that. It's like when you can touch joy inside of your heart whenever you're doing it. And that's amazing, so I hope everyone can find that. And I find that in plants and animals, and I hope I can give some of that joy that I have to you guys. So I hope you're having a wonderful day. And I'll talk to you guys later, okay? Bye-bye.